Well, trees, like all living objects, if they aren't utilized in a good way, they will go back to dust. There's a possibility of interrupting this sequence of life and death by doing something with a tree that will continue on. In order to express a great piece of timber, it has to be used in its ultimate sense and make it live into a piece of furniture. If it's done well, if it comes out right, it can be a thing of beauty. And this question of beauty, to me, is extremely important.
George Nakashima is recognized as one of the Earth's premier craftsmen. He has won prestigious honors both in the United States and abroad, including the prized Order of a Sacred Treasure from the government of Japan. His work glorifies the tree, symbol of strength and beauty. This oak, thought to have been alive when Columbus discovered America, is more than a living footnote to Nakashima.
I've known this tree ever since we lived in this area. It's a great oak. It has character. I think any tree that has grown to this age does have a good life. I mean, it's like an old man. Yeah, I guess I'm essentially a druid. I believe that there are ghosts in trees. In a very deep sense, a tree is more godlike than man.
His work starts at this sawmill in Nazareth, Pennsylvania.
The loggers and I know where the best grain is, and you have to cut the logs to expose the best part. Some trees seem to have a joyous life, and they express it in their fibers. Every step is a decision, and often very difficult. And on the wrong decision, you can lose several thousand dollars. It's a hard-boiled business. Good color, huh?
Until the grain and personality of the tree dictate a form, the slabs will join one of the world's largest collections of rare woods, 10,000 pieces in all. Dried for 2 years in lumber yards, woods from nearly every continent come to rest in sheds at the Nakashima family compound, a legacy for his son and daughter.
And you stand it right here on top of the ladder. I feel that every piece of wood has an exact usage. To find this exact usage becomes my job. And I have to feel that they have to be utilized to its utmost potential. Otherwise, it's a letdown for both myself and the tree. And there is a partnership there that's very important.
Starting with next to nothing after World War II, Nakashima designed and built an exquisite working and living environment, structures that seem to meditate on this wooded hillside in Bucks County.
How was your day?
I didn't get anything done.
Daughter Mira, wife Marion, and son Kevin are both family and co-workers, drawn together by a shared vision.
You have to relate to the board, you have to live with the board, you have to be a part of the board to make it evolve. It's something that's very subtle. It has to be developed in almost a psychic way.
Maybe 10, huh?
Yeah, maybe 10.
There's a feeling towards this board, a kinship, and there's an understanding to it and a reverence for it. And my job is to take this inanimate object that has died, it has been cut down, and to give it a second life. In a way, I'm probably the original hippie. And unlike the hippies, I had a program, and I think I've made it work.
Well, when we first started out, we had absolutely nothing. I have a little book and wrote down all the expenses, and the income was very little, and we had to go through a lot.
A 2-year waiting list and a complex work schedule are juggled on a blackboard by Marion.
I sometimes wonder how she kind of went along with me in my madness.
True madness would strip this Japanese-American couple of everything they had following the attack on Pearl Harbor in 1941.
We were put into these concentration camps. And Mira was just 6 weeks old when we first went in, so it was very difficult. I guess I'm sort of philosophic. We were put into these camps without any say as to whether we wanted to or not. And then after we got out, we just had to start building. That's what we did. It was just the natural thing to do.
From the internment camp, the Nakashimas came to Pennsylvania. Like the early settlers, they built much of their compound stone on stone.
We can roll out of bed and be at work in 5 minutes. Well, and I guess we'll take these worm tracks down, huh?
Okay. They don't go very deep. Should be easy.
And the ends match.
Now, at the age of 79, Nakashima no longer works the wood with his hands. His eyes are his tools in an intense one-on-one relationship with the wood. A group of European and American artisans have become the master's hands. They carry forward a tradition of elegant austerity, natural form into functional art, lines that evoke Shaker simplicity and Far Eastern aesthetics, three-dimensional tributes to the glory of grain.
Half is all right, too. You can just leave it, I think. Each man is, in a sense, his own boss, up to a point. So that I think the men feel have a sense of freedom here.
He has his own philosophy about the wood, and, his philosophy kind of rubs off on everybody else.
George likes the feel of the wood itself. He doesn't like any sort of film or anything artificial between the wood and the person that uses it. That's very important to him, the tactile feel of the wood.
You know, the wood to just about everybody around here is beautiful, and we all appreciate the fact that we were able to put our own spirit into the wood.
One of the concessions to modern tools, a router is used to turn a deep crack in this slab into a beauty mark. Using a wooden mallet for an even blow, a precisely fitted butterfly joint will hold the crack in check. The contrast in grain and color will also reward the eye. With little more than a saw, a chisel, and an awl, this dovetail joint comes together with awesome craft. The dovetail, a celebration of hand-hewn perfection. Even the spindles for Nakashima's classic conoid chair are born of hands, simple tools, and innovative construction strategies. Temporarily shrunk by heating, the spindle's end will expand to its former diameter after cooling, creating a non-loosening joint. A chiming art piece breaks the calm of the museum, also built on the Nakashima compound. Inside, the original conoid chair and other classic pieces. A life's work of design on display. A snowy day in January brings Nakashima face to face with a fallen giant. Gambling its centermost slabs will yield a pattern of great beauty, Nakashima hopes to build his greatest piece from this massive walnut tree. But trees, like people, have secrets hidden within them. The walnut secret stops the saw cold.
Set it down there just for a minute.
What happened, Scott?
Well, we hit a piece of metal.
There's a nail in there or an old steel jacketed bullet or something like that that we hit. If we've cut all the way through it, we might be able to finish this cut. Come over
this way. An object of unknown size embedded in the walnut years ago now threatens Nakashima's dream. If the obstacle runs too deep into the heartwood, the project will fail. They must dig and hope for the best. Trees cannot hide from men. Instead, they stoically submit to and absorb the fleeting presence of each human generation they outlive. Anchoring hooks from forgotten clotheslines, bullets meant to kill men in war, all become part of a hidden history beneath the bark.
Fantastic. Fantastic.
A piece of concrete and pipe is finally removed, perhaps once used by a tree surgeon years ago to prevent potential decay.
Woo! Right.
The damage is minimal.
Well, we haven't made very much progress today, but...
The next day, Nakashima's worries have ended with the snow. The potential masterwork, an altar to peace to be donated to the peacemakers of the world, will take its final form after the wood has dried.
Good work.
Good. That's pretty flat for as big a log as that is.
Yeah, that's good.
Pretty flat.
No twist.
No twist.
No twist.
Pretty flat.
Yeah.
Good. I'm happy with that. Yeah. A lot happier than I was yesterday. That's good.
Yeah.
I really like that.
That's
good.
A great log.
Yeah.
Trees, it has been said, hold the earth and heavens together. Branches embracing the sky, roots hard in the ground. Somewhere in between is the work of George Nakashima.